Thank you very much for having me. I feel like I should preface this talk by saying, and now for something completely different. I'm even further removed from the, so I think, the standard ECAL community. I'm a psychologist. I study people, and I'm interested in how, taking an embodied cognition approach to studying how people get up to the things that they do. And my talk is just introducing some of the concepts that we use in quantifying and formalizing embodiment in biological systems. And effectively, primarily what I'm going to do is I'm going to introduce you to a slightly different notion of information, which you may or may not be familiar with. It comes from James J. Gibson's ecological approach, which some of you may be familiar with Gibson for his notion of affordances, which I'll talk very briefly about. My main goal is I just want to introduce this notion of ecological information, because it is effectively the mechanism that enables embodiment in biological systems. And my plan is just to throw it at you and see if anything sticks, because I have the feeling it might be useful. And I know for a fact that in my field of embodied cognition, there's a lot of people pay a lot of attention to what you guys get up to. So all this morphological computation stuff and embodied robotics and a lot of these interesting ideas, passive dynamics and passive walkers, etc., a lot of it's filtered back in our direction. And so the overlap, I think, is there. But what I'm hoping is that the way in which we go about doing it in psychology and studying people and other biological systems might be of use. So fingers crossed. Okay. So I'm framing the talk in the context of task dynamics, and so I want to talk a little bit about what that is, because that's going to govern the nature of the information that comes out at the other end. So when I talk about embodiment, when I think about embodiment, I actually think a little bit more about just the structure of my body, right? In embodied cognition, fundamentally, the idea of embodiment is the idea that the shape of our behavior, the form of our behavior, is caused by more than just the brain. Okay, so there are more players, more constituents in our behavior than the brain. And there are various flavors of embodied cognition, most of which I'm going to ignore. The one that really kind of takes that implication the most seriously is the idea here that behavior isn't being simply internally generated and being produced by some internal command, but it actually emerges from the real-time interaction of a bunch of resources spread out around the environment, which include a brain and a body, but also include the objects and events and tasks that you're interacting with in the environment. Okay, so all of these things are coupled together, and they're all, quite usefully, they're all going to be dynamical systems, right? So hopefully that shouldn't be too much of a surprise for you. So usefully, or kind of critically, you can tell the difference between a task or an object or an event, if you like. You can only do it uniquely. You can only uniquely identify an event at the level of dynamics, right? So a category of motion produced by a pendulum, for example, is a pendulum-type event. But you can only identify that, you can only uniquely sort of characterize that at the level, at the dynamical level of description rather than the kinematic level of description. And so that points us to the fact that if we're going to do embodiment, if we're going to talk about all these different kinds of resources and things out and about in the world that we want to try and tie together, then dynamical systems theory is the right level to be talking at, right? We want a toolkit that enables us to describe all the key elements in the same language so that we can hook them together in sort of useful ways in our models, right? So that's great, right? If all the interesting kind of important stuff is happening at the level of dynamics, then we can describe all these disparate elements in the same common language. That's kind of the first step towards embodying behavior and getting it out of the brain. Okay, we want to be able to get these things in a common framework. So you may or may not be familiar, and I don't know how familiar you are. Dynamical systems theory is very hot and trendy in psychology these days, and lots of people get up to it for lots of different reasons. So here's just some models. This is a model of decision making. This is a model of the A not B era by Esther Fanon and her group. The A not B era is an era that infants make. It's a perseverative reaching era that Piaget first encountered, where an object and I hide it in one of two locations, and I get the infant to reach for it over and over again. And then in view of the infant, you pull it out, and then you hide it in a different location, and the infant keeps reaching to the wrong location, even though there was nothing subtle about the switch. So it's the A not B era, and this was traditionally kind of described as a problem with an object concept. But Esther's work was much sort of more dynamically framed, and the idea was really that was actually that this behavior of this perseverative reach was actually emerging from the interaction of an immature reaching system with the dynamics and the task demands. Okay, and so her model just simply includes a bunch of terms that characterize all of that. Same thing, visually guided steering is another big topic in that field where you get people looking at how we walk and visually guide ourselves as we locomote around our environments. These models are great and they're very productive and they do lots of good things and they're a good way of sort of formalizing the issues. One of the big problems with all of these models, which isn't sort of immediately apparent from sort of this, the description there, but you can just kind of take my word for it at this point. One of the problems with all these models is that they're great, but they don't include specific reference to the system in question, right? So the visually guided steering, for example, models, it thinks about the relationship between obstacles, for example, treats an obstacle as a repeller that you try to get around with, and it just models that as a simple mass spring dynamic. It's as if you were, or if you've got an aperture that you're heading towards, the same idea. And it's in the model effectively treats, say, the aperture as something that you're attached to by a spring, right? Conceptually, that's nice, and that captures a lot of the sort of phenomenology of the phenomenal sort of characteristics of the behavior, but we're not attached to things by springs, right? So the question is, can we just kind of up this a notch? Can we use dynamical systems to model the actual system as opposed to just this useful but fundamentally descriptive level of analysis? So dynamics is great. I'm a big fan of dynamical systems, and it's a good language for talking about all of this. It's a common syntax for all the pieces. But here's the thing. It's not a theory of behavior, and I'm a psychologist. I want to understand the behavior of organisms, particularly people. And so dynamical systems is the language I want to use to express all of that, but dynamical systems isn't going to constrain my explanations, okay? So what I need is a theory of behavior, and this is where James Gibson comes in. So some of you may be familiar with Gibson, some of you not. He was a psychologist operating from sort of the 30s through to his death in 1979. And what he did was he invented an entirely new way of thinking about information and perception and the control of action. And his two big contributions, one of which will be you'll probably be more familiar with the first one, is the idea that because perception is about the control of action, then we should be interested in perceiving our environment in terms of our ability to act on it. And that's the idea of affordances. Okay? So if you've ever come across Gibson, you've almost certainly come across the idea of affordances. Affordances are cool, and I study affordances and I like them a lot, but weirdly, they're actually the second most important part of his theory. The most important part of his theory, and that's what I want to focus on today, is the information that organisms can use to perceive things like affordances. Affordances are a bit weird, right? They're slightly complicated properties. And the question is, right, the central question is, right, affordances, I can describe an object in terms of its affordances, in terms of its ability, my ability to interact with that object. The question is, do I, the perceiving organism, detect and measure that object in those terms? Is there information available in the light, for example, for visually perceiving those affordances? Okay? So we now want to think about what the information is. And so for biological systems, we're not talking Shannon information. Okay? For biological systems, when I'm talking about this ecological information, I'm talking about patterns, moving patterns, kinematic patterns in energy arrays, so light for vision or acoustic arrays for sound, etc. And those patterns have to be informative in some way about the underlying dynamics of the event that caused them. Right? And here's what the standard sort of way of getting those patterns to be informative is that the underlying dynamics of the event structures light in such a way that is specific to the underlying dynamics, right? So I'm an organism, there's an event going on in the world, and that event has some dynamics, but my only coupling and contact, my only psychological contact with those dynamics are through these patterns of motion in the optic array. So Gibson's insight was that those patterns in light could be specific to the underlying dynamics. Even if they're not identical, which I'll get into in a minute, even if those patterns aren't identical, they can be specific to, they can map one to one. And so if I pick the pattern up, I can be said to be perceiving the underlying dynamic. Okay? Now this is a bit of a bottleneck because you want to get to the dynamics and only some of those dynamics will structure light. And so the question is, so you can only perceive anything that produces what's referred to as the kinematic specification of dynamics. Okay? So that's what I'm talking about by information. So in terms of embodiment, the setup is this. The things that shape our behavior are distributed, right? Some of them are brains, some of them are bodies, some of them are the objects and events that we're interacting with in the environment. Okay? All of these things are dynamical systems of varying kinds, okay? And their behavior, that dynamic, their behavior as it unfolds over time. Aspects of that dynamic is that they interact with energy arrays like light and sound produce specifying information, right? I'm an organism, I detect this information, and can therefore be said to be perceiving the dynamic, right? I have to do a little learning, obviously, there's nothing for free, but by learning to detect this information, I can be said to be perceiving the dynamics, which is what I want to be getting to, and that's great. And so what this means is if you're going to do embodiment in biological systems, you need something very much like ecological information as a mechanism, as the actual thing that enables these distributed resources to be hooked together into a system that can possibly do anything. Otherwise, as far as embodiment is concerned in biological systems, it's all smoke and mirrors. Okay? You have to be able to hook these things together. Ecological information is it, right? Okay, so I want to talk a little bit about how we in the sort of embodied cognition community can go about quantifying this and being as specific as possible about all of this, because the goal is to get away from this descriptive stuff and get into mechanism, right? So I wrote a paper with my co-author and sort of all-round partner in crime, Sabrina Golonka. We wrote a paper a little while ago sort of taking this approach and laying out a research program in a paper we somehow got away with calling embodied cognition is not what you think it is. We just described a research program in which you could do a little science on this. And the goal, I just want to walk you through an example of this research program from my own work. Okay? So a little audience participation. Now everybody hold your index fingers out and hold them out in front of you. I want you to move them up and down in phase with each other. Okay? Nice and easy, nice and straightforward. You can do that all day, every day for the rest of your life if you want to do no problems. Now get them moving in anti-phase. It's 180 degrees. Nice opposite. Nice and easy. Now speed up. Speed up, speed up, speed up, speed up, speed up. Hopefully what you're finding is it's getting harder and harder and harder and harder to maintain that 180 degrees. And some of you might even have switched into doing zero if you don't fight it too hard, okay? So it turns out that this is just the thing, right? It turns out that we've worked this task to death in the field because it's an interesting little perception action dynamical system that we can get some traction on. And the basic phenomena are, without training, 0 and 180 are the only two rhythms you can sustain for any length of period of time and over a range of frequencies. Zero is more stable than 180, so if you increase frequency, you'll switch from 180 to zero, but you tend not to go in the reverse. And everything else needs to be learned. You don't need much practice, but you need some training, and especially the intermediate syncopated rhythm, 90 degrees, which is the hardest of the lot. And the question is, why in God's name does such a simple task have this structure, right? So taking this research program and trying to get a handle on this, right? So it turns out that you run a bunch of experiments and you figure out what it is you actually need in order for this particular pattern, this particular dynamic to show up. And you need two things, moving rhythmically and autonomously relative to one another. Some experiments demonstrating that that's what has to happen. Those rhythmic movements need to be parallel to each other so that you can uniquely define relative phase. The two things can belong to different people, so I could be in charge of one finger and you could be in charge of the other one and we'd still get the same pattern result. But it has to, or actually I could have one person and interacting with a computer display. There just has to be a person in there somewhere. The coupling, therefore, is not in the head. The thing that ties these things together is not in the head, it's perceptual, it's informational. There's an informational coupling here that seems to be doing a lot of the work. When you figure out the resources in this task, all you've got is a couple of oscillators moving in a particular way that you're trying to get to move with respect to one another. And what you need, what that dynamic produces is some information. It produces information about that coupling and how well it's going that a system can detect in a bunch of different ways. Visually, you can do this with your eyes closed, etc., and do it proprioceptively. So what you've got is two oscillators and you've got some information about their relative motion that allows you to try and maintain that phase. So now the goal is to get a bit more specific. Let's build a model that actually has those things in. It's not just the idea is that this isn't just a description of sort of the dynamic, but it's actually, these are the things that are actually built into the actual system that is you when you wiggle your fingers like this. And this is a model from my PhD supervisor, Jeff Bingham, which we've done a lot of work with, and I've done a lot of experiments based on it. It's a nice, very simple, friendly model, right? There's your action components, a couple of damp mass springs, because that's what rhythmically moving human limbs are, it turns out, okay? Here's the informational component, right? These things are being driven by the perceived phase of the other one, modified by the relative direction. Hold the phone, I'll get into that in just a second. The trick is these things are coupled through the information, right? This one here is being driven by the perceived phase of this one, and vice versa, okay? And so the coupling happens over here in the information. This model reproduces all the basic effects, that's great. And it now enabled us to do a whole bunch of stuff. It makes a very particular prediction. It predicts that the perceptual information, the specific kinematics that you detect in order to perceive relative phase, is the relative direction of motion. Okay, and it does this. This then accounts for a bunch of the phenomenon. Relative phase, there's no, at the level of relative phase, there's no difference between 0 and 180, but behaviorally there is. Turns out informationally there's now a difference between 0 and 180 when the information is the relative direction, because that kinematic information now, 0 degrees the relative direction is consistent and it's always the same. 180 it's consistent, but now it's always different. And at 90 degrees it's the hardest condition, it's maximally variable, right? So the model makes this prediction for various reasons based on some experiments. So now we just science the hell out of it, right? The question is, we've got a description of what we think people are actually organized as. Let's see if it's true. And the model is very successful, right? It explains a bunch of the previous effects. It explains why the effects persist between people. Why? Because the relevant coupling is informational, not neural, conscious, and previous hypotheses. It explains why the effects persist without movement. I can give you displays that are just moving at various relative phases and get you to make judgments about those displays, and you get the same pattern of results out. 0 degrees is very easily discriminated, 180 degrees less so, etc. There's no movements involved. The interesting thing is in the information about the motion. Okay? It explains why the effects go away if the feedback takes away this relative direction. You can give people leases you display as feedback, right, instead of doing all this, and all of a sudden everything becomes very easy because relative direction is no longer a problem. Learning rates vary. If I train you to do something close to zero, you're faster than if I try to train you something close to 180 degrees, and that's because the information is more stable close to zero, and so on and so forth. Then there was a whole bunch of stuff that I tested in experiments that came out of my dissertation, and later I trained people to be expert visual perceivers without training them on the movements, and without any additional training on the movements, their movements got better, right? So I trained them to do 90 degrees, be able to move this way just by training the perception. We've just published a paper where we successfully predicted transfer of learning, and we've also successfully predicted no transfer of learning between these different feedback conditions and accounted for it in terms of these models. Okay, so that's a simple, dinky little task, but the reason it's nice and the reason why we get so much action out of it is that the dynamics are very straightforward, the information's very straightforward, running the experiments where we've poked and perturbed this system are relatively straightforward, so we've been able to get a lot of mileage out of it. And it's just it's a test bed, right? It's a proof of concept and a test bed for demonstrating this idea. But the real action here for embodiment, if you want to tie these disparate resources together, you need something like ecological information, and you have to take it seriously. Okay? So ecological information in biological systems is the information, is the mechanism that supports embodiment. Okay? So in my field, to get serious about quantifying embodiment and being able to actually really get a handle on it, the thing that's been most successful is taking this guy as seriously as we've been able to. Okay? Here's what I don't know, whether or not any of that is useful to you guys. So the reason why it's interesting for me is that understanding that, for example, relative phase is perceived as relative direction, allows me to explain why people's behavior looks the way it does. You guys, if you're out building your system, you're not limited automatically to some of these information variables that are initially available to biological systems and the kinds of things that biological systems latch onto. So for example, if you want to build a sensor that's sensitive to something a biological system isn't sensitive to, you can build that sensor, and that's fantastic. The advantage of ecological information, first of all, is it comes from tasks, right? And so tasks are task specific. Performance is task specific, and that's actually quite useful, because tasks offer specific opportunities to interact with them. Task-specific solutions tend to be very robust. They don't generalize, perhaps, but they tend to be robust, they tend to be smart, they tend to be fast, and they tend to be efficient. Right? So taking advantage of the local dynamics and coordinating with the information produced by those local dynamics is an effective solution as a biological organism. And it also then constrains our science when we go trying to figure out what it is they're doing if we have that dynamical understanding. What I'm hoping is that maybe these ideas are useful to you guys too, as you're going about trying to figure out ways of tying these things together. Starting with the local dynamics and the dynamics of the task that you're actually trying to achieve, coupling to the information that that task produces is how you evaluate whether or not you're producing functional behavior, right? That's how you connect functionally to a task, that you connect to the information that that task produces. And so now, all I really want to do is find out if any of that makes any sense to any of you, and is in any way the kind of thing that might be fun for you. So that's me, that's how to find me, if any of that was interesting. And thank you very much for having me. I appreciate it.